Shabbat Shalom. How's it sound? We're about ready to go live, Cody. I don't see my worship team. Help! 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 Well, welcome to Yeshua House. Service starts at 7:30. Please make sure all mobile phones are silenced during the Shabbat service. Let's go. We're going to get ready. Show me when we're ready. We're having some internet problem. We're all good. We're on the internet. Praise God. Welcome to Yeshua House. Shabbat Shalom. Interesting week. How many people have had interesting weeks? Amen. Well, we're getting into our Passover season, and this week we're going to touch upon that. But the key right now in the next few weeks, we're going to need volunteers for Passover. It's April 14th that we're going to have to start sending out our flyers. And we try to have everybody start getting here by 6 o'clock, sat by 6:30, and we'll be having the service at 7. Okay? So that day is going to be early. Also, I got a new kind of really cool thing here. This is a pointer for the Torah. This is an antique. This is extremely cool. If you ever see it, if you want to come up here, it's mother of pearl. This is bronze and gold, and this is what they use to read the Torah. So Shaul's going to be using this. This is probably 80 to 120 years old. I got it for $30. And I had it fixed and cleaned and everything. It's probably worth about $500. So I don't want the kids coming up here and smacking it or anything like that. Please. But I'm going to leave it up here tonight, so if you guys want to look at it, it's extremely... Huh? eBay. Lowest bid. But it's... If you look... This is handmade. This is, like I said, it's about 100, it's 80, anywhere between 80 and 120 years old. Extremely cool. I showed it to Shaul, and he's like, see, when you read the Torah, you have to go like this, you know, and you don't want it, or actually this way, but you don't want to touch it. And so this is really cool. I'm excited about it. Also, Sunday morning, we got some new worship people. Yay, Chris and Latoya. And so Sunday morning service, it started off really good this week with their worship. It kind of just kicked right in. Sunday morning, we have a guest speaker. Pastor Ev, is he speaking on Sunday? So he's here. We're trying to get everybody up to speed. It's all about foundation right now. We're trying to get people to read their Bibles, get things fixed in their personal lives so they can grow up. Amen. The best way, actually in Hebrew, reading your Bible is the highest form of worship. That's reverencing God through the reading of the Bible. Two is praise and worship. And we're going to go ahead and get ready for our praise and worship. We're going to have our praise and worship team come up. We like David. We've been praying that you move over on this side of town. Amen. So, was that traffic pretty bad out there? No. Okay.
Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's really give him the praise and the worship he deserves tonight. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shabbat, Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat. Let's pray, come on. Let's pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Let's pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Let's pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Jerusalem shall live in peace. Come on, let's say that again. Let's pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Let's pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Let's pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Jerusalem shall live in peace. Come on, declare with me. Shalom, shalom, shalom. Sing it again. Shalom, 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 Jerusalem. Let's sing it one more time. Come on. Hallelujah. Put our hands like this. Wash away my sin. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, oh, precious is the blow that makes me white as snow. I know nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Hey. Nothing. Nothing can force sin at all. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not a good that I have done. the blood of Jesus is enough. Let's sing that one more time. The blood. Oh, the blood of Jesus is enough for me. Oh, the blood of Jesus is enough. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood. Oh, oh, precious is the blood that a good father. We worship you, oh Lord, for you alone are worthy to receive all honor and praise. Highly exalted, Lord God Almighty, we'll sing out, oh, bless the name Yeshua, for he is the name above all names. Hallelujah. Bless the name Yeshua. Messiah gave his life in my sending your son, who gave himself a ransom for our sin. Perfect atonement, spotless Adonai Yeshua, Redeemer of Israel. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed Yeshua, for He is the name above all names. Hallelujah. Blessed the name Yeshua, Messiah. Messiah gave His life in my place. Yeshua. Yeshua gave His life in my place. Thank you for taking my place, oh Lord. Bow and worship as the angel voices swell. Fragrant clouds of incense around the throne of grace. Lord, we bow and worship at the brilliance of your face. We cry, the song that heaven sings. All creation praise Him. Hallelujah, Elohim. Come to reign forever, King of kings and Lord of lords. Lift your head, O Zion. Open wide you ancient door. We cry, the Lord. Holy is the Lord. Holy are you, Lord, the God of Israel. Oh God, we're waiting here for you, Lord. Holy Spirit, would you move in such a mighty way in this place? We lift you up tonight. If faith can move the mountains, let the mountains move. We come with expectation, we're waiting here for you. Us from the start. Singing a hallelujah. for everything you promised. Your faithfulness is true. We're desperate for your presence. All we need is you. We're gonna sing hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. Singing It is you, O Lord. It is you. We lift our hands and worship to you, Lord. It's only you, God. Oh, it's only you. And I'm singing hallelujah. 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 Most beautiful name, most wonderful name. Jesus, the most beautiful name of all men. When I speak your name, mountains move, chains are loosed. When I speak your name, darkness flees. It has no hold on me. Jesus, most beautiful name that I know. You're the exalted one. The lonely one, exalted. Be exalted. Be exalted. Higher. We lift you up higher. Be exalted. Be exalted. Let's sing it again. Be exalted. Be exalted. Be exalted. We exalt you, oh. Be exalted. Be exalted. Be exalted. Higher. Exalted, oh. High. Be exalted. High. We praise you tonight. Thank you, Lord.
Saying these are my days, and yes, they're numbered. Every day is numbered, from the first to the last. How do you address that day? How do you tackle that day? Which side are you on? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Father, we thank you that we are your sheep. We hear your voice. We ask for this time that your presence be felt, your word be shared. We thank you, Father, for the Passover coming up and this season of Purim. Whatever we do is never going to be the same sacrifice as Yeshua. We thank you for Yeshua. We thank you, Holy Spirit. Bless this time in Yeshua's name. Hashem. Amen. Praise God. Wow. Is that a new guitar?
Yeah.
Is it your old backup?
No.
Oh, praise God. You know, David Letterman has his guy. I got David. Welcome to Yeshua House. We're getting ready for the offering. This season, we're going into the Passover. And you wouldn't really believe, you know, when we have our Passover meal, we end up spending close to $4,000. Anybody realize that? Lamb is not sheep. Sheep. Lamb is not sheep. But so we're getting ready for that. But it's also one of our biggest outreach times where people can come in and they get to kind of see the Hebrew side of the Passover and how everything fits together. And so in the next couple weeks, we'll be selling tickets. And it's a really good witness. And we've spoke to several people lately about you know, hey, you need to come for this, come for the Passover. If you haven't been here, Jason, or if you haven't seen the Passover, it's great. You know, and so Rabbi Shaul's going to be doing the Passover. And we're going to be literally next door. So we'll have this building open and that building open. And so we're going to kind of do open house. And it's going to be a long day. So if we have some folks taking the day off, we're going to be cooking lamb. I mean, that takes like 6 hours just to cook all the lamb. It's 100. We're going to cook about 120 pounds of lamb. It's really, 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 really good. Yang. That's how they say it in Chinese and Korean. Yang. How do they say it in? Yes. It's April 14th. Yang. Yeah. April 14th. We'll be getting in here at 6 o'clock to start seating. So we'll be next door. We're going to use the same tables. We're going to move our tables and extra chairs. So we need manpower. So if you can get here early that day or get off work early, because we're going to have to go over, set everything up. Usually we used to set it up Thursday night and then Saturday or Thursday night, then Friday just have the service. But we're going to have to do everything in one day. So we need help. Also, Sunday after service, if you have a child, please attend the lunch, because after lunch we're going to have a meeting. It's going to be an open meeting because we need more helpers with the children. Amen. So Pastor Danita is going to be doing the service meeting. Hi, Gloria. If anybody wants to meet Gloria, she's a hoot. She is. She's just right there. But, Sunday we have our meeting, and then we have our 2 o'clock meeting. Monday, Daniel's been teaching. How's that going? Julie, he's doing a good job. Daniel's doing a great job, right? Sisters group, Tuesday morning. Wednesday, we're having some powerful meetings. We're going to be talking about that on Wednesday night and the purpose of them. But, you know, we're now coming in a full stride. This is our season coming up. So invite folks. We have room for 250 people. And we haven't maxed out yet. So just bring them on in. Let's pray over the offering, Hashem. Father, we thank you for all the seeds that are planted, that every family that has contributed be blessed, that the first fruits come, and that they will have a harvest off it. Father, we thank you for the offerings and the love behind them. In Yeshua's name, Hashem, amen. Where's Pastor Kimberly? Oh, hi, Pastor Kimberly. You want to use my tallit? Pastor Kimberly lost her tallit. We got a tallit in the lost and found? No? You can use my tallit.
Shabbat shalom.
You're stepping on it.
Oh. Thank you. Why this church we talk about the Passover? Have you ever had a Passover at your church, previous church before? Is anyone? Not this church? The other church? Let me tell you what right here. I just want to share the Leviticus 23, verse 5 said, in the 14th day of the first month, and next month will be month of Nisan, will be first month. And then the day of the first month at the even is the Lord's Passover. Lord's Passover. Again, in the Bible said this is the Lord's Passover. Not the Israelites, not the Jews, not the Gentiles, not the Yeshua house. This is the Lord's Passover. Then who is Lord in the New Testament that I want to share with you? That in the Matthew 12, I think the verse 8. Here, This is a very famous verse that said, "For the Son of Man is the Lord even of the Shabbat day." I just ask you that about the Passover is the Lord's Passover. Now, who is the Lord? And here, think about verse 8 said, "For the Son of Man is the Lord even of the Shabbat day." Another word is Yeshua is the Lord of the Shabbat. Wait a minute then. Then who Yeshua is? He is the Lord. Who made the Shabbat? Lord did it. And then Yeshua said he is the Lord of the Shabbat. Why we keep the Shabbat so important? That in the Bible said that the very key verse about the Shabbat is the remember this day and keep the holy. This is it. The Shabbat is the remember this day and keep the holy. Because the Shabbat is the Yeshua is the Lord of this day. And then the feast is a Moadim, God's appointed time, God's promised time is everything is for Lords, not the Jews, not the Israelites. So many people didn't thought about the feast is the Lord's feast. It's different with the, like last week we had a Purim. Purim, we don't have to celebrate. The Purim is the people of Israel. So we need to know the difference. But when Bible said the Lord's feast, Lord's Passover, the Lord of Shabbat, then we as the children of Israel, children of God, have to keep this and remember forever and ever. And Shabbat is the most feast. We should keep this, even like last week I said that when new heaven, new earth will come, we serve the Shabbat to the Lord. So this is the hour about the Shabbat. And again, Shabbat Shalom. So the best gift that I get for Shabbat is that I can have a Shalom. What God gave us, the Shalom. Do you need a Shalom? Can you say Shabbat Shalom? Amen. So we are entering at this the lighting moment. We are entering in His presence because this is His Shalom time. I'm entering the Shalom time. So close your eyes. Just proclaim your Shalom from the Lord. Rogata donai lo henemela kaulam asher kidishane be mitzvotav betivanu lo hadrem dorshel shabbat. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of universe, who has sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to kindle candles of Shabbat. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. We're getting ready for the Passover, and each holiday is a relationship holiday. And we're going to go ahead and pass out the elements. Kimberly has a gentleman who's a rabbi from Israel, born in Israel, really putting pressure on her to take him to Korea. Well, the problem is he's a Judaizer. He wants to teach Judaism. And there's a arrogant spirit where we deal with these people that they're Jewish, they're in the body of Christ, and they think they have something up here that we don't have. Well, that's not true. It's the same thing that we deal with. We have the Pharisees in the church systems that we deal with too. And the Pharisees, at least the Pharisees believed in the resurrection and the ascension. They believed in that. And then the Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. That's why they were sad, you see. And so, you know, we go back and forth. And we look at these Judaizers who pursued and went after the early church. And then Paul was one of them. And then he became a believer. And we're constantly asked these questions. And this gentleman wants us to take him to Korea. And when we go to Korea, what happens is we're teaching about Jesus. We're teaching about the Holy Spirit. We're teaching how the Old Testament and New Testament is connected. You know, the Old Testament, New Testament was never divided. It was actually the Catholic Church that separated the Old Testament from the New Testament. All Scripture is divinely inspired. We know that. So these Judaizers come in and they pick off people in the church. And I wanted to say this, the lady's not here. A few weeks ago, we had a lady in our church that was wearing it looked like a hijab, almost like a Muslim deal. And she was asking people, why don't you have your hair covered? Yeah. That wasn't from me, okay? But how many people did she hurt and we don't know about it? And see, the body of Christ needs to be inclusive, not exclusive. We exclude people based on something that we see in them, but we can't see that log in our own eye. And so, you know, the whole purpose of the Passover is to deliver us. Well, I don't need deliverance. Is that your first clue that you need deliverance? Usually it's their first clue. Well, I don't need deliverance. Well, that's check number one. Yes. Excuse me? The original church, because the Catholic Church, when the Constantine was overran, the Eastern Orthodox Church was separated from the Roman Catholic Church. Okay, because you had the Coptic Church and everything, but I believe it was a time during at Constantinople. No, that's what people are taught. The actual history was that when Constantine took over the church in 325. Okay, and during that process, after 325, that's when they went through and they canonized different Bibles, different books of the Bibles. But we're in the middle of this. Okay, all right, thank you. So, the question has to do with the timing and the Catholic Church, you know, and see that goes back to, we understand the early church existed from when? When the Holy Spirit came down in the book of Acts. Amen. So that was the early church. It was 100% what? Messianic, 100% Spirit-filled. Understand that Jesus was the Messiah. Hashem. So Father, we just praise you for the holidays, the feast, everything that you've done for us and given us examples. We ask, Father, in the name of Yeshua, that we follow you, not by the letter of the law, but the spirit of the law. Now we have the understanding of the purpose of this time, because you said that the latter rain will follow the early rain. So the patterns of the early church and the patterns of the last season will be the same. Father, we thank you for the harvest that's coming in Yeshua's name. Hashem, amen. Baruchat Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam, Borei Pri Gafen. Blessed are you, O God, King of the universe, that brings forth the fruit from the vine, Yeshua, the King of the universe. And the bread, Baruchat Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam, Hamotzi Lechem Mi'aretz. Blessed are you, O God, King of the universe, that brings forth the bread from the earth, Yeshua, the bread of life. Amen. We do a lot of teaching here because I think the more you know, it helps your foundation of the church. The season we're in right now, we're in the book of Exodus 34, through Exodus 34:22, and we're going to read through verse 28. Or actually, verse 29. How's that? Did it cut off earlier? Wow, how did that happen? Oh, Father, in the name of Yeshua, I come against every technological demon that's been attacking us tonight, from the internet to the speakers to the sound system. We bind them all right now with the blood and the word and the name of Yeshua. Hashem, amen. Yeah, we were during worship, our internet was cutting in and out, and we weren't getting our volume. Exodus 34:22. You shall celebrate the feast of the weeks, that is the first fruit of the wheat harvest, and the feast of the ingathering at the turn of the year. Now, there's two New Years in Hebrew. Go on. Verse 23. Three times a year, all males are supposed to appear before the Lord God, the God of Israel. Now, the Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, if you believe in Jesus, that's your God. We had a little issue Wednesday night. We were, Brett had left Wiley's house, and I left, and he left, and I turned around, I forgot my phone, and a lady is running for school board. And she comes up, and she starts passing out a flyer, and I started asking her questions about socialism and all the stuff that's going on in the school system and what she approves. Well, Dano was standing there because she was trying to pass out something to Dano. And the Holy Spirit told me she was a Mormon. So I take her through the ropes. And I have her on the ropes. And I basically, she goes, well, what's your solution? I said, homeschool. And I said, look, there are two or three grades ahead. It doesn't cost. The families that want to put their kids in there, they're doing it. It's not about social indoctrination. And I said, by the way, there's a lot of Mormons that are trying out for the school council. And she goes, I'm a Mormon. Did you like that? Was that a kill shot? Huh? Yeah. She goes, I'm a Mormon. And so I was trying to explain to her that she does not believe in the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Now, the Muslims will say, oh, we believe in the God of Abraham. They don't believe in the God of Isaac and Jacob. Ishmael and Esau, the God of Ishmael and Esau, those are different people. Ishmael, actually most Arabs are from Esau, and Ishmael, no, his God was a Egyptian God. And so we got this confusion right here. So three times a year, we should come to church. Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter, right? Is that how most people come to church? You think I'm you, right? They big days. No. This was at that time because they had to walk a day or 3 days to get there. So the all males are supposed to appear before the Lord God of Israel. Verse 24. Click. For I will drive out nations before you, enlarge your borders, and no man shall covet your land when you go up three times a year to appear before your Lord your God. Which day should we appear? Passover? Shavuot, Pentecost, Sukkot, how about Sukkot and possibly Yom Kippur? If you can make, I know Sukkot, but Yom Kippur is important too. The we're required. Thank you, honey. But yes, What is the highest holiday then, Professor Kim Burley? Oh, okay. So I would include Yom Kippur. So that's a minimum of the three, and we'll throw Yom Kippur in there. Go on. But there's promises attached to that. See, this is what I'm trying to get at, that there's promises. You shall not offer blood of my sacrifice with leavened bread, nor is sacrifice of the feast Passover to be left over until the morning. So we have to eat everything next in 3 weeks, 4 weeks, we have to eat everything. Next, you shall bring the very first of your fruits of your soil into the house of the Lord your God, and you shall not boil a young goat in its mother's milk. Stop right there. Most of the confusion right there about you shall not boil the young goats in its mother's milk, this is where a lot of people get the kosher mindset, what kosher food is. This rabbi that's trying to get Kimberly to take me back to Korea, she goes, well, how do you eat over there? Oh, I'm Orthodox rabbi, but he's not, because he's not eating the food. He's eating the food. It's not kosher. Right, baby? Also, we need to bring the first fruits of your soil in the house. When they harvest it, we were talking about this the other day. Sean pointed this out. We got the barley harvest, the wheat harvest. What's the next one? The fall harvest. Where they would take a chunk and bring it all at one time. They wouldn't come in each week and give a little offering. They would bring a whole chunk in during these times. And we've talked about this before. So, you know, the offering is actually 26.5%. That's the offering and everything. And when we talk to the pastors, if we don't believe in the Old Testament, then I tell them, how about if you got 26.5% income from each person? They would be, yeah, but 27. Then the Lord said to Moses, write these things down. This is the second time up the hill. Write these things down, for in accordance with these words, I have made a covenant with you and Israel. Let me explain something what Kimberly was talking about with the Shabbat. Jesus is the Lord of Shabbat. He said that right there. I'm the Lord of Shabbat in John. Also, the covenant was given at Mount Sinai, not in Israel. They did not get the Ten Commandments exclusively in Israel. The people of the world, most people at the time, were functioning under what covenant? Noah's laws. They were following Noahic laws, Noah's laws. Here, God ups the ante with the covenant of Israel, the Lord, you know, the covenant of Abraham, and gives the Ten Commandments. I have made a covenant with you and with Israel. A third of the people that were with them were Egyptians. And so when we deal with all these people that are getting into this Judaism way out here, no, I can show you the early church was 100% messianic. They were Hebrew. And when the temple was torn down, that's when Judaism was created. And 300 years later, that's, or 250 years later after that, that's when we got Catholicism. And 100 years after that, that's when we got Islam. Verse 28. So he said, so he was there with the Lord 40 days, 40 nights. He did not eat bread or drink. He wrote on the tablets the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. Verse 29. It came about when Moses was coming down from Mount Sinai, and the two tablets of the testimony were in Moses' hand. He was coming down from the mountain, that Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone of his speaking with him, God, Adonai. Verse 30. So when Aaron and all the sons of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. Verse 31. Then Moses called to them, Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned to him. Moses spoke to him. Continue 30. Afterwards, all the sons of Israel came near, and he commanded them to do everything that the Lord had spoken to him on Mount Sinai. Verse 33, this is actually our text we're going to touch. When Moses had finished speaking with them, He put a veil over his face. This is the story of the Holy Spirit, God being in communion with Moses at the level that he actually was radiating. It's a little chilly in here. And he was actually radiating Tuesday at the sisters group. We had a young lady come in, and we led her to the Lord, and her countenance changed. Powerful, 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 powerful. We've had we had other people come in here, and they're getting these breakthroughs, and you can see the countenance change. Now, when it said that they had finished speaking with him, he put a veil over his face. I guarantee you that was a tall leap. Amen. Amen. And I was talking to Daniel today on back and forth on texting, and it says, is it Jeremiah? It says that there's ten men will grab the hem of the Jewish man's garment. Well, actually, it's going to be 10 unbelievers will grab the hem of the believer or the tallit. The question we have this week is, how much time have you spent with the Lord, and have you had that kind of experience? And I was kind of convicted today. I spent about three and a half hours praying in the Spirit. It was really, really good prayer time. And I had some old worship music. How many people ever turn on old worship music? There's actually some good stuff out there. And I was sitting there. I was just kind of... I started listening to, well, this is a little hokey, but all of a sudden my spirit man started going, you know what? We need to be a little bit more honorable, a little bit more clean, you know, clean-hearted than this. It says, Moses has come down from the 40 days and 40 nights from Mount Sinai with Hashem, unaware that his face was glowing. The Torah said that his skin was radiant, and that he called Aaron and the leaders of the assembly to share with Hashem what Hashem had been telling him, and that he put the veil on the so he wouldn't scare the people. Remember the Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston? Remember when he comes out and he has that surfer hair, you know, all platinum blonde? That actually happens in real life. It could happen. Your hair can literally change color overnight. I'm praying against that, but Kimberly had a dream the other night that we had five daughters. And I would say, well, what if I woke, you know, I'd be waking up with her and five more sets of eyes staring at me, telling me what to do. I don't know if I could handle that. My hair would probably change color. There was a transfiguration at the time of the mountain. There was a mountain experience where Moses went up, and guess what? He got the word of God. He had spent 40 years in the desert. He came, rescued Israel out. He set his priorities down. This man could have been Pharaoh. He set everything down, so he became meek. Meek is not weak. Meek is following the plan of God that he has for your life. And when you start bending towards that, that's when God empowers you. We're going to talk about the transfiguration today. We're going to talk about the change that happens to people. And in Matthew chapter 17, we're going to read a lot of that. So Matthew chapter 17, verse 1. We've been doing a lot of discussing lately, because we have a lot of people that are coming in wanting the Spirit of God, but they have no foundation. And then the flip side of it is they don't want to clean themselves up. I spent the night last night. Kimberly and I went out to dinner, and it was a... How long did you wait inside the restaurant? I'm so sorry. I was talking to a guy in the parking lot. And this guy had pulled me over, saw me, pulled up as we started talking. I started talking to him literally about 30 minutes. I'm so sorry. But it was for ministry, baby. I'm telling you. And he was upset. And he was telling me the story of what happened. His 13-year-old daughter got on Facebook, met a guy on Facebook, and was raped by her. And so I was sitting there counseling this guy in the parking lot. He grew up Catholic. He knows I'm a pastor. And so I got stuck there. And I was literally trying to minister to him. And we're blocking traffic and everything. And he got to the point where he told me the whole story. And it was really bad. The guy's in prison. But he's like, he doesn't know what to do about his daughter being broken. So I went through my experience. I explained to him. But I told him the most important thing, you get healed so you can help your daughter. And I explained to him what we're doing with the deliverance ministry. We're about the forgiveness and what we're taking people through. And there has to be a change in us. There's a point in time where we have to grow up as Christians. Just because we have a degree doesn't mean we know anything. There are life experiences that we have to know about and have had. You can't be marriage counseling if you've never been married. Hello? You're not going to be telling me about kids unless you've had a few kids. Amen. And so these life experiences and the Word of God, your prayer time, and I saw when I was praying, literally God building a foundation with your prayer, your reading of the Bible, your devotion, and your church attendance. Like a square, like you're making a foundation. And that the Holy Spirit is what pours into you. And our conversations this week with Pastor Pam and I, we throw the ball back and forth. One of the conversations is about the foundation that people aren't allowing the Holy Spirit to fill them. They're jumping around from church to church trying to pick up some information. They're trying to find something that they'll fit in their pocket or a fad. You know, years ago they had some people out in, I don't know if you remember this, Karen, out in the mid-cities where they were running around with squirt guns squirting each other. Did you ever hear about this? It was like, well, this is the Holy Spirit. Ooh. And so people were showing up to church with the Holy Spirit. Probably how it started. The kid came to church with their squirt gun. The mama took it away. The daddy's falling asleep in church, so she's squirting them. And that turned into a whole fad. Did anybody remember this? This is back when the laughing anointing and the Rodney Howard Brown. Okay. So, we can't turn an event into a movement. Because God deals with each of us differently. Let's read Matthew 17, 1 through 7. 6 days later, Jesus took him and Peter and James and his brother and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before him. His face shone like the sun. His garments became white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. I believe those are the two witnesses. Well, not Moses, but Elijah and Enoch. But for this case, you know, there's an argument about that. I'm not going to get there. Peter said to Jesus, Lord, is it good for us to be here? If you wish, I will make three tabernacles here. That's what people try to do. They get in this religious mode. It's like, well, we got to create a statue. We got to make an idol. One for you. One for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. Hallelujah. Verse 5. While he was still speaking, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud said, this is my beloved son, who I am well pleased, listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their face. At least Jesus didn't have to answer that stupid question. They fell down. face down on the ground, and they were terrified. And Pastor Pam was talking about this the other night, about getting prostrate before the Lord, just laying down. Jesus came to them and said, and touched them and said, "Get up, do not be afraid." Lifting up their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. Oh, I said one through seven. We're going to go back to eight. During this first part, there was a contact made, a supernatural contact, and it was a validation of what? Who Jesus was. And he was validated by who? Moses, which was actually apostolic. Moses was an apostle. Would you call him apostle? I was taught that he was actually apostle, and the prophets. And the church is founded on what? The foundation of the apostles and the prophets. So we have to keep that. Understanding that Jesus was being validated here for this reason and season. As verse 8, and they were lifting up their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus alone. We're going to go through verse 13. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, "Tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man has risen from the dead." He uses this expression over and over. The transfiguration is in the book of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. You can go back, and they're all very similar, so we're just using this Matthew because it's the easiest one. Verse 10, and his disciples ask him, "Why then do the scribes say Elijah must come first?" Well, first of all, if you look in the book of Malachi, which was the last book that was written, that was under the Jewish, it talks about the spirit of Elijah. The first book of the Bible, of the New Testament, and we call it the New Testament, it talks about John the Baptist comes in the spirit of Elijah. So Jesus answers in verse 11, and he answered and said, "Elijah is coming and will restore all teachings, restore all things. But I say to you that Elijah already came, and they did not recognize him, but did to him whatever they wished. So also the Son of Man will be suffered at their hands." This has to do with John the Baptist. The disciple understood that he had spoken to them about John the Baptist. One of the stories in the Hebrew commentary about Elijah, that when Elijah interceded, this is very similar to the stories of Sarah. When Sarah was in captivity under Pharaoh the one night, she prayed and interceded that Pharaoh would not come to her. And that all the Hebrew women were protected while they were in Egypt. Now, the commentary said that Elijah would pray prophetically. He would see the future in his prayers, and he would have that prophetic insight, and that he would actually be speaking to the scribes and the people that were in prayer. So it was almost communication spirit to spirit. I'm not really into that, spirit to spirit, because there's so much witchcraft out there. And now we have what? The Holy Spirit. We don't need to hear from other spirits. We don't need to get into fortune telling or witchcraft or any of that stuff. But so when he talked about John the Baptist, they all recognized that he was coming in the spirit like Elijah. He was not reincarnated, but he came, and we see that in Matthew chapter 1. Verse 14, I love this, we're going to say here. When they came to the crowd, a man came up to Jesus, falling his knees before him, saying, keep going, "Lord, have mercy on my son, for he's a lunatic." Okay, this is not my dad. And he is very ill. Okay, I'm healthy. "And often he falls in the fire." Never done that. "Often into the water," sometimes. Verse, I'm giving commentary. "I brought him to your disciples, for they could not cure him." How many times Jesus went into a circumstance and that people were bringing a person, when it said lunatic there, it actually has to do with moon worship. Moon worship. Yeah, Luna. Moon worship. And that they got the demons from Not that Luna family back there. Okay, we got some Lunas in the place. Oh, I apologize to anybody that's Greek. You got anybody that's Greek here? All right. But he had demons. And he had gotten involved into moon worship. And Jesus answered his disciples and the rest of the folks, you unbelieving, perverted generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Is this the pastor of the church? Bring him here to me. You know, he had sent them out to use the name of Jesus. Remember those 70 people? I believe a few of them were in the crowd. Verse 18. And Jesus rebuked him, and the demon came out of him, and the boy was cured at once. We have people transfigured in deliverance ministry. In 2 weeks, I'm going to New York, and we're going to the Korean IHOP people. Is that what they are? And I'll guess what? I'm doing 2 nights of deliverance ministry. Next time I'll send you. You can go. And the thing is, we have common background. We know how things operate. And so some of these things we're dealing with, that lunatic was actually a religious spirit. And I see that over and over, that people, they'll come to Jesus and nobody will train them. First of all, there's not a lot of fathers in the body anyway. There's a lot of teachers. Everybody wants their name, write a book, blah, blah, blah. But they haven't trained or been trained in how to get rid of some of this demonic stuff. First of all, they're not clean. You can't cast out something that you're involved in. If you're smoking, you can't pray for somebody else to quit smoking and expect them to quit. That's an issue. If you're drinking and somebody has an alcohol problem, well, I'll pray for you, brother. Go home. No, it doesn't work that way. That's my Popeye impersonation, too. And so one of our battles we're having, this man I was dealing with yesterday, last night, I knew he had a gun in the car. He wasn't going to use it on me. I had two guns in the car. No, he's a good guy. But he had such rage in him. And so I had to tell him my story and how I had to pick that garbage out. And you know what? It still hurts. But I was able to witness to him, and we have to become better witnesses. But until you've gone through the fire and been healed, forgiven those people, walk through this stuff, you're going to have a really hard time in life. It's not affecting them. It's not affecting them. But there's a point where you got to get transfigured based on what Pastor Pam was teaching the other night. I was getting text messages while you were teaching. I didn't tell you this the other night. Good. People need to hear that. People need to, if they come in here and get healed, they need to stay here and stay delivered. What happens? They come in and they go to the deliverance ministry and they get a little healing. They go back to their church. Well, we don't believe in that. We don't believe that you can have a demon. Well, the word there in Greek is demonize. And we've turned it into demon possession. The demons don't possess you. You have free will. We know that. Because the demoniac came to Jesus. He had free will. He went to him and Jesus got rid of the demons. So here, Jesus rebuked them and the demon came out and the boy was cured. The anointing, let's go back to, is it 14? Verse 14. Okay, I got a translation issue. Verse 17. Let's see that. Okay, it's not in this translation. I was reading a translation. You ever read a translation and the word is different? Yes, it is. It's actually in a different translation. I don't have it here. It said that the anointing, he was vexed with demons. He was vexed with demons. I guess that would be verse 18 then. he was vexed with demons. He rebuked them, but Jesus had just been gone through the transfiguration. He had the anointing on him. What do you think the anointing looked like on Jesus that day? Imagine that. Walking in that power, understanding that you have a job to do. There's a lot of people, we've been talking about faith lately, there's a lot of people who are name it, claim it, blab it, grab it. Have you ever heard of that? Because I keep mentioning it. Yes, you have. And that name it, claim it, blab it, grab it issue is this. You can have anything that two agree upon, but there also needs to be God's will. Now, if you're not a good steward, God's not going to give you something. We had years ago, one of Pastor Pam's old people came in here, and I prophesied, and the Lord showed me what? He had stolen money from all of his employees, ripped everybody off, and that he needed to repent and give the money back and make amends to people. And he goes, no, you know, that's wrong. The prophecy is I'm going to get a lot, $10 million. I was thinking, you're smoking crack, buddy. Why would God give you money if you're cheating people? Right? And somebody had given him prophecy, oh, you're going to be a millionaire. And here he is ripping off people. Well, maybe if he paid everybody back, started all over, started tithing. Isn't tithing part of deliverance, isn't it, Pastor? Hello? This man did not want to change because somebody had prophesied that he was going to be a millionaire, and whatever he did not matter. He could cheat, rob, steal, and kill. I don't think he killed anybody, but everything else, right? When people are vexed, the only thing that will break that yoke is the anointing. And the only time you can get that kind of anointing is when you've spent time with God. We have to get into not only good fellowship. We need, I want to thank Sean. He helped me plant grass the other day. A couple pallets. Are you a little sore? Yes. But we kept an ongoing conversation about Jesus and what's going on and everything. And we have to have fellowship, continuous fellowship. And that's why it's not good for men to be alone. Correct, baby? Let's go to 2 Peter. Let's go to 2 Timothy first. 2 Timothy 3:16. 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture is inspired by God, profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in legalism, in Phariseeism, in righteousness. Now, when we put the TVs up here, I was kind of concerned that people didn't understand this, but I like watching people actually reading Scripture. Amen. And we've been pushing getting the Bibles. On Tuesday, we had the Gideons come in and give the sister group Bibles. Did you like that? So we got a bunch of Bibles, and it's all about the Word of God. All Scripture is inspired by God. Where did Moses get the Ten Commandments? By God. Jesus, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, Yeshua. So, all Scripture is inspired by God, profitable for teaching. That's the first purpose of all Scripture, is for teaching. If you're not reading your Bible, you're not learning anything. Best way to read your Bible, read it out loud. It goes out your mouth, from your mind, your soul, out your mouth, into your spirit man. We want to develop that. If you want to turbocharge the Bible, pray in tongues, reading out loud as you're reading the Bible. How many people do that? that's good stuff. You get that power download. Because that's where the revelation knowledge starts coming in. For teaching, what's reproof? Correcting your messes. Getting you back on track. Getting things organized. You know, explaining what sin is. Oh, is that a sin? Yeah. For correction and for training in righteousness. There's a point in time that Paul, from the road to Damascus, by the way, pray for Israel. They're being attacked by Syria. Has anybody been watching that? Okay, I'm the one that, you saw that? Paul, on the road to Damascus, the second highest teacher in Israel, he was a Judaizer at the time. He was killing everybody and, hey, you got to do the legalism, what we're doing. He ends up spending 3 years in training in the Holy Ghost before he went in the ministry. We got too many people want quick fixes, right, Pastor Pam, Pastor Kimberly? They want to come in and throw the ball, be king and everything, and they don't want to go through that maturing. For training in righteousness, that's an ongoing process. Let's go to 2 Peter chapter 1, 16 through 21. And you know, we pray over this because we're in a season. We finished the book on the Holy Spirit, which was a great foundational tool that a lot of the Chinese people have gone through. We still have some copies back there. We're also teaching on faith now. And there's a reason for that, because if you don't understand the Holy Spirit and have the Holy Spirit, your faith becomes unstable. If you're not praying, you're not in devotion, then you got some problems. Now, the thing that we do know is in the prophetic that there's a validation of the prophets by the prophets. And next week we're going to have presbytery. Be ready, Nico. Wherever Nico's at. Presbytery, we're actually having some pastors. Remember Pastor Richard Billingsley? He's coming in here. We're going to have the prophets come in. We're going to lay hands on people, and we're going to prophesy. It's actually pretty cool. I'm in. Second Peter, chapter 1, verse 16. For we did not follow devised tales when we may know your power. That word devised tales is fables. How many people have translation fables? Fables, there you go. Fables, when we made known to you the power and the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, but we were witnesses of his majesty. Every other religion is based on the revelation of one man. Ask that Mormon lady. One man. I said, go home, Google Mormonism and Islam. It's the same thing. Hello? And I asked her, I said, well, is your husband going to resurrect you? Oh, yeah, kill shot. Is your husband, because in Mormonism, if you're not a good wife, you know, Mormon women have the highest suicide rate in the United States. Because they have to be perfect, little robots. And if your husband doesn't love you or you're not good enough, he doesn't have to resurrect you. Because he's going to have other wives up there in heaven. Right? Sounds like Islam. It's not good. So she tells me, she explains to me her husband's not a Mormon. I go, well, who's going to raise the resurrect you? That boom. The witnesses at the cloud that watched Moses go in the cloud was numbered 600,000 people. 600,000 men. Because they consider a witness a man. I'm sorry. 600,000 men watched what? Moses ascend into the cloud, and they heard God speaking to him. It wasn't Moses coming down giving revelation about the situation. They all heard the echo and saw everything happen at one time. There were 600,000 witnesses. The problem was it was probably so overwhelming they didn't know how to receive it. They never spoke to God. See, a lot of times God's in here speaking to us, and guess what? we're not tuned in. The other night I was sitting up there and the Holy Spirit says, go over there and talk to Dixon and his wife and take him out to Denny's. So I go up to Dixon and he goes, hey Dixon, you want to go to Denny's? He goes, hey, we got a coupon for Denny's. I'm like, yeah, boy. I was hearing the Holy Ghost. I love that kind of stuff. And so you have those witnesses here, and the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ is what? Witnesses. You have an entire nation on the highest, one of the highest holidays, watch the king, literally, Jesus had rights to be king of Israel, be crucified on the highest of holy days. They saw the veil ripped from the top to the bottom. It was 30 feet tall and 3 feet thick. Wrench, ripped from top to bottom. They had an eclipse. We call it an eclipse. It got dark. And lightning. Wow. Everybody in Israel saw that. Everybody knew something happened that day. We were witnesses of His majesty. We also are witnesses through the Holy Spirit and through the Scripture. As we were talking about last week, more we read our Bible, more we become witnesses and understand the reality of God. How do you explain to somebody that's dealing with a daughter that's been molested that, you know, you have to forgive somebody? Well, until you've been a witness and gone through the fire, you're not going to be able to tell much. Our country's in a real critical point right now. I posted a thing from Mario Murillo. I love the guy. On Facebook. And this is like the calm before the storm. We are under serious persecution right now. And we don't even know it. The hammer is about ready to drop against a Christian church. And your power comes when you understand the Holy Spirit and how to stand against the schemes of the devil. We have to understand how to stand our rights and fight for our faith. This is part of end time stuff. But let's go on. Verse 17. For when he received honor and glory from God, from God the Father, such an honor as this was made by him, by the majestic glory, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. And see, I want that when we die and we're resurrected and we go for the judgment seat, he's a good and faithful servant. Amen. Verse 18, and we ourselves heard this utterance made from heaven when we were with him at the holy mountain. This is just not one man having a revelation, looking in a hat with a stone. I'm talking about the Mormon. If anybody wants to study the Book of Mormon, go watch South Park. They have a Book of Mormon. And they really lampoon it. But he is talking to the hat and had a magic stone. And this woman believes that Jesus came over to United States and witness to the Native Americans. Mormonism, they believe that. They believe that. They believe that Jesus and Satan are brothers. Oh, we're all a part of the heavenly family. I go, I'm not a part of that family. I've seen those people. Oh, well, we got lots of prophets. Yeah, your prophets are 33 and 34 degree Freemasons. Those are people that are in witchcraft that have sacrificed babies or killed somebody. And they're in our government. Criswell. God bless Criswell. Hey, how many people have heard of Criswell College? He forced the Southern Baptists to take the Freemasons out of the church, the Baptist church. He did. And you know what? They're sneaking back in there. And I can't tell the Baptists from the Mormons anymore. I'm serious. They got the same shirt. They got the same smile. God bless you, brother. They go to lunch at the same time on Sundays. It's scary. And the thing that we have to have is what? The glory. What's the glory? The Holy Spirit. Let's turn to Romans 10:17, and our faith starts clicking at this level. Romans 10:17. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. The word of Christ is the truth. Faith comes when you hear truth. Do you have to defend truth? Do you have to defend the truth? Well, yes, we do. But I'm going to tell you this. Defending the truth is like defending a lion. Can you defend a lion? No. A lion, you let him out of the cage, he will stand his own ground. A lion can protect himself. The truth is a lion to a lot of these people. Because we remember what Satan does. Satan goes around like a roaring lion, telling lies, deceiving. His only power is deception. So when we have the truth, and people are rewriting American history, people are talking, you know, stupid stuff about the Bible. Well, fine. St. Patrick's Day today, eh? Isn't it St. Patrick's Day? St. Patrick led 120,000 people to the Lord. Did you know that? He was a slave for 17 years. He was a Briton, by the way. He was British. He was in slavery, got out, forgave them, and went back and led them all to Christ. And the shamrock, the three-leaf, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's what it's supposed to mean, right? Not the lucky four. That's, what is that, lucky stars, lucky charms? So faith comes when we hear the truth, and we know that the truth comes from Jesus. And so when we lead somebody to the Lord, like we did the lady the other day, what happened to her? Her face changed. Her countenance changed. Her heart changes. We see these transformations in people. And then they go home, and somebody throws water on their fire. Well, you know, I know you're zealous for God, Sean, but, you know, one of these days you're going to get all tired out like me. Right, Sean? Have you ever had that happen to you? You've been on fire for God, somebody come up and say, well, you'll cool down. Oh, yeah, you'll cool down. No, it's not going to cool down. We have a purpose. We have a function. We must do what the Lord tells us to do. Jesus was tested in the desert. Oh, let's go back. Let me finish my. The Bible is a foundation to our faith. So if we're not reading the Bible, and you come up to us, and you want to be a prophet, and you're not reading your Bible, what do you say, Pastor Pam? We got to have the Word of God in you. You have to have the living word, the rhema word, the logos. You need it all in you. Why? So it could be reproof. So when it's tested, you don't have to worry about if it's going to come true or not. When you get the word of knowledge, hey, yeah, going to Denny's? Yeah, boy. Right? I do that all the time. It was like when that Mormon lady was sitting there. Did you notice how I dropped that bomb out of Mormonism right out of left field on her? Yeah, when I first brought up Mormonism. Yeah, Dan was like, well, how'd you know that? Because I was sitting there listening to the Holy Ghost. And that's how we're going to have victory, when we have the discernment through the Holy Spirit. Jesus was tested. He tested the word in the desert. We have to learn to put demand on the word of God. Have you ever heard this? People don't understand that. There's certain demands we can put on the Word of God. We're not tempting God. We're not going to push him out. But Jesus, let's go to Luke chapter 4, verse 1. Luke 4, 1. And I want to thank our guys are getting much faster back here. Thank you, Augustine. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led around by the Spirit in the wilderness. Leave it right there. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit. How many of you guys are full of the Holy Spirit? If you're baptized in the Holy Ghost, you're full of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Then Jesus went out in the desert, and guess what? He was tested. How many of you are being tested this week? All right. How many, are you praying in the Spirit? You getting up praying? Amen. He was led around by the Spirit in the wilderness. That's our whole lives, guys. Hello? Now I'm going to fast forward. He went through the testing, and what did he do? He had to put the word, put a demand on the word. Satan would come up and challenge him, and he would come back and say, but the word says this. You have to have right application at the right time. Too many people are talking about the fivefold ministry, and they don't know what it is. They've never been around people that are actually prophets, apostles, evangelists, pastors, teachers. Somebody called me up the other day, and they said, well, you know Heidi Baker. Who was that? Was this in the room here? Somebody was telling me about Heidi Baker. I go, Pastor Kimberly knows Heidi Baker. We were at the lunch table last week, and somebody said something. I met Lester Summerall years ago. That's amazing. Love the man. I was under Kenneth Hagin. You know, Pastor Pam was under the Frieda and Gordon Lindsay. These are people of God that we can look back in our histories and say, wow, we got to have examples of God-fearing people that walked at a level of holiness and power and understanding of the Word of God. And these people were devoted to the Word of God. I'll tell you what, Gordon Lindsay, he was a word person. Kenneth Hagin, he had almost 3/4 of the New Testament memorized. It was, you know, when you get that kind of word in you, and it's rhema, and you got it memorized, then you can start throwing the ball. Most of us are making mistakes throughout our Christian lives, and then God backs us up and gets us on the right track. I was talking to Daniel yesterday, and I said, it's kind of like, we want to do this straight line, right? We're sailing the boat. How many people ever sailed a boat? So you sail the boat. You can't go straight line. You have to tack. You have to change the sail with what? The wind. And so you go over here. Then you go over here. And you think it's 1,500 miles, but by the time you're finished, you've gone 3,000. But you got there. Most folks don't even have their sails up. Hello. They're not listening to the Holy Spirit. They're not praying. They don't even have a compass. They don't know what to do. Verse 14. And Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Holy Spirit. He was full of the Holy Spirit. Oh, I'm full of the Holy Spirit. I'm full of the Holy Spirit. Where's your power? Show me the power. Everybody in witchcraft is looking for what? Power. All these people want the power. That's why people come to church. Well, this is a good story about Jesus. He's a nice guy. Probably sound like a good teacher, possibly a philosopher. Yeah, good story. I want the power. We crave power because we need victory. Until you shift over into the foundation of the Old Testament, New Testament, have the teaching, have the camaraderie. Pastor Pam's here every Wednesday night. I'd be the first one in the door. You need to get healed. People need to get that garbage out of their system. Well, I used to do that. Well, don't incorporate it into your life now. You know, I went into a bar last night. Did you know that? Oh, I'm going to get in trouble now. Well, after we got done eating, I was worried about that guy. And he was literally a couple doors down. There's a hamburger place that sells beer. It's a sports hangout. Chicken wings. And I went in there looking for him. And you know what? I just saw all these dead people. I'm going. Because I didn't want him to do something stupid. Because my spirit, and so today I went over to the where he worked, and he had called in sick. And, you know, I'm praying for him. You guys pray for him. I won't tell you his name, but we We need those kind of people in here because the world is dying. I hate to say it. They need Jesus. Every problem you have, the answer is always Jesus. And if you want to whip up the spirit in your own strength, nothing's going to happen. You can sit there and get 10,000 people praying for one person and nothing happens. That person has to come in agreements with you. That person's going to have to want to get healed. Sometimes they have to what? Repent. Ask for forgiveness. Be forgiven. Forgive others. When they go through this process and all of a sudden they got the breakthrough. That's what kind of church this is. That's what's going to bring the revival. We have a fivefold ministry church. And if you're in this church and you come in, and I say it this way, people come into Yeshua House and they get one nostril above the waterline. You know, like they're drowning. They got one nostril where they can barely breathe water. Oh, I'm doing better. And they go out and they fall down. And you know what? Then they turn around and they blame us. Oh, that's not real over there. They didn't fix me. Our job's not to fix you. Our job's to lead you to the water. Our job's to lead you to the grass. Our job's to set the example in our lives. The devil attacked Pastor Pam this week. I told Pastor Kimberly, "Go, this is just the devil. Just let it be. Watch what happens." And I'm assuming you were pretty excited to see your grandkids. So we had this whole big old schedule messed up, and then the she gets a phone call. I don't want to call her granny. What do they call you? Nanny? Nana. Nana, we're in the airport. We're leaving right now. Forgot to tell you. They were going to stiff her, and she changed her whole schedule. That's the devil. We have to have enough discernment and forgiveness to operate in love in our group. When the devil's attacking somebody, we don't turn around and attack them even more. That's what happens way too much. Well, why is it important? Because the devil's after what? The anointing. He's after the fact that we're talking about this stuff where no other pastors want to talk about it. Pastor Pam's up here talking about deliverance from pornography. All these other sexual addictions, alcoholism, drugs, witchcraft. What I'm talking about right now, hey guys, it's killing you. And it's robbing you. You can't have the life you want. God has put a measure of faith in you that you want a lifestyle better than what you see that you got right now. Even Christians. Well, what do you mean? Hey, Christians have problems. We're going to have a wedding seminar coming up, the husband-wife thing, what they call it, marriage seminar. Sound good, baby? Yeah, boy. She's smiling. She's smiling. But we're going to see breakthroughs. We had a lady come in here from San Francisco. We dealt with her. God just touched her heart. God's sending the right people at this time. And we want you to reach out to people because if you get healed and you share Jesus, they're going to see what Jesus can do. And when you start changing your attitude and you start changing your heart and you start forgiving people, some of that garbage just falls off. It just falls off. It goes away. And then the word of God starts growing in you and you get stronger and stronger. And your mindset starts going, well, you know, it's like we were talking about the shack the other day. It gave you freedom. I've talked to, you know, different people have different experiences. So I'm not going to criticize that. But I was talking to somebody today, and the first time they saw Derek Prince about the grace message. And they were like, wow, we got set free from that. Then it went into hyper grace. We want to teach you some kind of balance in between that you can handle something without being affected. That's why when more you have the Word of God in you, you read your Bible, you say, well, hey, you know what? I see that. It's good. That's okay. You know, what did Kenneth Hagin used to say? Chew the hay, spit out the sticks. How many people have sticks in their mouth? A little legalism. Well, I thought this. Well, I knew that. And then all of a sudden, we got this thing called progressive revelation. Closer we get to Christ coming back, we actually have more information. Isn't it amazing? Things are being revealed about Israel. Things are being revealed about the Bible. Things are about being revealed about the Holy Spirit. We all need it. We all have to walk in this progressive revelation as we do what? We surrender our prejudices, our bad doctrines, the lack of devotion. We have to surrender our time. We have to start contributing to the churches that are feeding us. We need to start getting involved with other healthy people. We need to lead people to Christ. You want to see the power of God? Go lead somebody to Jesus. I'm serious. When we prayed for you a couple weeks ago, I'll tell you what, the anointing came in here so strong, I almost fell down. That's what it's all about. It's not about your name or, oh, I'm a prophet, I'm an evangelist, I'm a pastor, or I got some kind of logo. No. You have to get real about the salvation, your salvation, and talking about salvation, and walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. You have to be transfigured at some point in time where you're going to change and say, you know what, that's my old man. That's my old self. I'm a new creation. I'm a new being. God has changed me inside out and given me more power and revelation about who I am and what I'm supposed to do. And all that fear is gone. I'm comfortable in my body. I'm comfortable in my skin. Seriously. All that pressure goes away. All that sickness goes away. All that anxiety, all that fear goes away. All the addictions go away. And when people start walking in that kind of freedom, they're going to come up and say, what's up with you? You go, Jesus. Jesus is always up. He's up there. He's getting ready for us to come back down. Amen. And when you have that glory on you and they see that in you, they're going to want it. Do you know how to share Christ? I know sometimes, you know, in cultures, and I love what we have at Yeshua House, because cross-culturally, we can minister to each other. And Catherine brings me people all the time. It's like, she needs prayer. It's like, okay, lead her to Christ. Lead her to Christ. What was it? Almost 100%, right? I don't know how many people we've led to Christ. We want more of that. And having a cross-cultural church keeps us all honest. Did you ever notice that? Within our own cultures, we had these little sneaky games and, you know, little things we do on the downside. You know, all that stuff. And we got to change that whole momentum. We have to understand this priority. This is the last minute. We have to get the ball across the line. We got to close the deal on these people because they're going to die and go to hell. Or they're going to go kill somebody and they're going to go to hell and that guy goes to hell. And then the Holy Spirit that we have in us is sitting going, let me out. Let me out of God in your lives. People say, well, why do I need to be a Christian? I can do drugs. I can feel good doing drugs. I can drink alcohol. We have to have a consistent devotion, interaction, relationships where we don't look like we're the freaks anymore. And when they come to us, we're stable. We're strong. We got the word of God in it. When we speak, the power of God hits people and they don't know what to do. They're like, wow, the anointing, something's coming out of you. What is that? What have you been eating? Garlic? Yeah, I'm getting rid of those demons out of you. You know. This is where we're at. We're going into Passover and we have to shift. We have to shift. And until you shift. You know, revival's not going to come because Pastor Pam's up here teaching them or we come teaching them. It's when every one of you stand up and take responsibility. And your healing's complete, right, Eva? The blessings are coming into your family, Pat. Your children are all turning their hearts. What does the Bible say? Amos 9:13. The hearts of the children will turn to their father. Well, it also turns to their mama, too. We have to get the scripture in you so you know what to talk about. Because the truth is only the scriptures. We need to know which one to use at the right time. That's why we have the Holy Ghost, right? Father, in the name of Yeshua, we ask for that revelation knowledge. We ask that you change our hearts. I want everybody to put their hands up. Say, Father God. I hear him. I hear something coming from heaven. We're just waiting for that train to go by. Father God, open my eyes, my spiritual eyes. Open my spiritual heart. Show me the things that I need to remit. The sins that I need to get out of my life. The forgiveness I need to give to others. The repentance of things in my life. Father God, convict me. Holy Spirit, convict me about daily devotionals. That I need to spend more time with you. So I can be transfigured. So people can see that glow on me. That they will know that I've been with the Father. That I've been with the Holy Spirit. That I've been with Jesus. Father, touch my heart. Hold me accountable this week. Teach me what I need to do. Build me up through your word. Through prayer, through fellowship. Father, Lord, show me the next step. Let me take that next step. Let me step up into that righteousness that you have prepared for me. Your word will cause righteousness. It's not self-righteousness, but right standing. I want to be in right standing with you. In the name of Yeshua. Hashem. Amen. I believe we're going to have what we've been talking about, that revival. I spoke to the people in New York, and I told them what I was going to teach on, and they were like, that's exactly what we need. Because we have too many people chasing. We're going to go ahead. You can turn us off. Too many people chasing fads, and they're not grasping the Holy Spirit. They're not getting things that